Perfect. Do you have, does anybody have any question related? Okay, that's great.
Thank you so much. No, for me.
Yeah, very good, very good. So let me share the screen and let's go to our tutorials page. Today we will talk about climate change. I am anticipating the last link. I will change the order here in order to put it just after the last lecture that we did, which was beach protection strategies. And this climate change is what we are talking about today. It is something that it is extremely relevant to coastal resilience, harbor management. As you know, everybody's talking of climate change today. The focus here of this lecture is in general climate change and water cycle, but there is, as you will see, so the title is climate change and water cycle, but there is a large part of it which is devoted to sea level rise, that is what is relevant to us. But in any case, this whole discussion on climate change, it's something that is extremely timely. And therefore, it is something that I really want to discuss with you. It is very narrative, this lecture, so there is only a few quantitative information. So this means that it's unlikely that this lecture will be the subject of questions at the exam. Still, it is, as you will see, very relevant in order to get a better understanding of what is the impact of climate change in the context that are relevant to us, which means ocean, coasts, coastal resilience, etc. This lecture is quite long, so it will take, I think, the whole of our time today. There is a PowerPoint at the end of the lecture. As usual, the lecture is reporting a lot of information with several links for you to expand. The page is, the document is not optimal for teaching, and therefore I prepared this PowerPoint presentation, which I am now downloading and I will follow today. Here it is, and here is the PowerPoint. PowerPoint is basically putting together the pictures that are in the over the web, but in a more let's say in a more catchy way and in a more easy way to read. First of all, why the lecture is called Climate Change and Water Cycle? First of all, because I want to emphasize that we are interested in water, water in the ocean, water in the rivers, and water in the underground. But the reason why I wanted to stress the importance of the water cycle within the topic of climate change is that the impact of climate change over humans, over society, is taking place through water, through the water cycle. Because if you think of the impact, it is given by hurricanes, which means water. It's given by floods, which means water. Droughts, as well, water. And coastal flooding, which means water. Coastal management, which means water. Ecosystem, again, water. There are few impacts of climate change where you cannot really see a key role of water, like, for instance, hot waves or forest fires. But still, you understand that even when we talk about hot waves and forest fires, the role of water is maybe less evident, but still it's there, because, of course, for controlling fires and for the propagation of heat waves, clearly water plays an essential role. The water cycle, it is something that we know from a long time ago. We were taught the first time the water cycle in the primary school. It is something that we believe we know well, On the other end, I want to emphasize that actually we don't know much of the water cycle. We know the big picture, which is what you can see on the screen now. So we know that it is describing the travel, the perennial travel of water from the oceans through evaporation to the atmosphere, and then through condensation and precipitation back to the land, and on the land back to the ocean through surface flow and the groundwater flow. So we know this big picture. We know that this cycle is driven by the energy given by the sun, like climate change is also climate in general, is fueled by the energy of the sun. The Earth system in general is fueled by the energy from the sun. On the other hand, when we have to describe in detail the water cycle, and the detailed description is needed in engineering, is needed to make predictions, is needed to make to estimate design variables, when we go to the details, actually we cannot describe them for many reasons. There is a reason due to limited knowledge. There are reasons due to the fact that the geometry of the system, it's difficult to translate into a numerical scheme, because part of this geometry we cannot observe. Like if you think of groundwater flow, etc., it is the geometry can hardly be defined. And therefore, again, when we come to the detail, when we want to get the details of it, we end up with a limited availability, limited reliability of our prediction and our estimation of design variables. And in the context of oceans, this is relevant for predicting the sea level in the future. It's relevant for predicting how the dynamics of winds and therefore waves will change in the future. It's relevant also to predict the extent of saltwater intrusion, which depends on, in turn, on groundwater flows of fresh water. And therefore, you understand that it is, from an operational point of view, a big open question, the description of the water cycle, and then the estimation of the impact of climate change. In fact, if you pay attention to the media, there is an unanimous recognition that climate change is a problem. There is an unanimous recognition that we have to start making action, taking actions for mitigate it. On the other hand, when it comes to putting this will into practice, there is a lot of debate about it, because it's not really clear how we should make, how we should design our actions. And in engineering, it's not really clear how we have to adapt our design procedures to take into account climate change. So it's a big open question. And for this reason, I think it is relevant that we discuss it. Actually, the research is very active. It's very active on climate change. It's proposing solutions. Keep in mind that these solutions are in their infancy. So it is necessary to stay continuously updated. The lecture that I am presenting to you has been quite a significant effort in order to put together technical information, for the very reason that it's not easy to get technical information. I tried to emphasize the orders of magnitude in order to be able to understand what is the impact in numbers, not just in perceptions. This lecture is quite updated, and I would say that it's the information that is reported there is at least less than 10 years old for some of them. Some part of it is very recent. I think it is quite updated, but keep in mind that we need to stay continuously updated on this problem. You can find on the web several other pictures of the water cycle. This other one is basically saying the same thing as the previous one. This is a picture that is in the public domain, which emphasizes the role of ecosystems, the importance of the water cycle for ecosystems, and therefore on the important role of the water cycle on climate and on ecosystem services, which you know that are extremely important, have been recognized as playing a key role for sustainability, for ensuring that our natural resources are exploited in a sustainable way. I like the next one, the next figure, which it's a bit harder to read. You don't have to read it now. What is nice in this figure, I think, is the emphasis of the human impact. The figure has been developed by the United States Geological Survey. It's in the public domain. And it's a bit more complicated, but it's nice, as I said, that we can see here the sum of the causes of the human impact on the water cycle. The water cycle is severely human impacted, not only through climate, it's also human impacted through the use of water, and therefore the withdrawal, for instance, of water from rivers, the withdrawal of water resources from the underground. It's impacted by pollution, because clearly water courses and groundwater are vehicles for contamination, and therefore if you think at the release of the sewer systems, for instance, in surface waters, it's impacting the water cycle. It is also impacted by agriculture, by the management of the land in general, and in particular agriculture and land use change like urbanization. Urbanization causes a decrease of infiltration, and which implies an increase of surface water, of the flow of surface water, and a decrease of the groundwater flow, of the groundwater recharge, which means a decrease in the groundwater flow. So there are several impacts, and in turn, taking into account these impacts, it's not easy. So once again, like for climate change, there is an unanimous recognition that humans are impacting the water cycle. When it comes to quantify this impact, it's a problem. It's a problem because it's still a problem, a description, for instance, of groundwater flow, groundwater resources. We cannot estimate it, the extent, the volume of groundwater resources. So clearly, if you cannot describe the system in its pristine condition, you cannot, of course, describe the system under human impact. Okay, so now let's pass to the essence of climate change. What is climate change? What do we mean with climate change? First, it is important to stick on the definition, to have it clear. So, and what I want to be very clear is the definition of climate. So climate, it's can be defined as the statistical distribution of weather variables. Weather is the day-to-day condition of the climate system. This is weather. So when we say that today is sunny, we are talking about weather. If we say that on average in March in Ravenna it's sunny, this is a statistic. I said on average, and this is climate. Statistics have to be computed over a long period. So weather refers to a time location, a point in time, like a day, like an hour during a day. Climate is a statistics in the long period. How long? Traditionally, climatologists say that the statistics should be computed over a window of at least 30 years. It's not written here, but it's written somewhere in the web pages. So, when we talk about climate change, and now we can read on the slide, we talk of something which can be defined as a long-term change in the statistical distribution of weather variables. This is climate change. This change may be naturally induced or human induced. This is important to say. When we say climate change implicitly, for an implicit agreement, we refer to the human-induced change. There was a similar term that was in use up to some time ago, climatic change, which was used by the World Meteorological Organization during about 50 years ago to identify long-term changes in climate irrespective of their cause. So they used climatic change to mean changes human-induced as well as change induced by volcanic eruptions, by the impact of asteroids. By the way, I'm not sure if you look at the newspaper today, they just discovered an asteroid that is traveling toward the Earth and will pass quite close, I think, today, and will pass again in 3 years from now, even closer, but the predictions say that the probability of hitting the Earth are very, very low, the predictions up to now. Okay, so these are events that may change the climate. The impact of asteroids may change the climate permanently. And it is believed that in the past something like that occurred. And these events cannot be really predicted with reliability. This asteroid was discovered just a few hours ago. So we cannot predict in advance the income of asteroids. Once that we locate them, we can predict the prosecution of their trajectory. But at the beginning, they are observed with a little anticipation in some cases. This is something that is interesting because it gives to us the feeling that it is nature, the evolution, the progress of the universe, the evolution in time of the universe is also dominated by random events which cannot be easily predicted. Today we have the illusion that we have the scientific knowledge and the means to make a certain prediction of the evolution of the Earth system, but actually it is these events give us the feeling that it is not easy to make these predictions. And this asteroid that has been discovered, to give you an idea, is as big as the Colosseum in Rome. So it's not very huge, but still an impact would mean something really relevant. And you may remember the last impact, it was 10 years ago, I think, in Russia, where hundreds of people were hurt by the fragments of an asteroid, which came quite unexpected. So it is interesting because we realize that there are some events that cannot be easily predicted. And also climate cannot be easily predicted. Anyway, let's come back to our definition. It's important that you have understood the difference between weather and climate. It's important that you understand that climate is quantified through statistics. It's important that we understand that when we say climate change, implicitly we mean human-induced climate change. What about the change that is not human-induced? How can we call it? A term that is largely used, it's not mentioned here, but it's mentioned in the web pages, it's natural variability. When we say natural variability of climate, we mean changes that are induced, not human-induced. I think the term is misleading because variability implicitly gives the feeling that the change is reversible, like something that is going up and down. Natural climate change may be also irreversible. Something may happen, like the impact of an asteroid, which changes forever the state of the Earth system. So variability is, I understand why they call it in this way, because they want to give the feeling that nature, it's variable. On the other hand, it's important to be fully aware that the difference between the two types of changes is just that one is caused by humans and the other one is not. But in terms of their dynamics, in terms of their results, they are more or less the same. Okay, now, what is the cause of climate change? We all have heard about the greenhouse effect. The greenhouse effect means that there is an increased by humans emission of CO2 in the atmosphere, and this increased concentration of CO2 builds a kind of a screen which stops, which traps the heat that is emitted by the Earth as a reaction to solar radiation. So we have solar radiation that goes, that heats the Earth, and the Earth surface bounces back part of the heat back in the atmosphere. And then this greenhouse effect traps the heat into the atmosphere instead of allowing a greater part of this heat to go back in the space. So the result is that, keep in mind, the greenhouse gases don't stop the solar radiation. Clouds, for instance, they stop the solar radiation, and then they also contribute to the greenhouse effect. But in a way, there is a compensation. The greenhouse gases don't stop the solar radiation. They can only trap the heat that is emitted back by the Earth. And therefore, the result is an increase of the quantity of heat in the atmosphere, which means an increase of temperature. It's important that we know that the greenhouse effect is something natural. There is a natural concentration of CO2 in the atmosphere. And CO2 is the most cited gas among the greenhouse gases, but there are other components like aerosols, methane. Methane is playing a relevant role also. Now, as I said, this is some of these gases are naturally dissolved in the atmosphere. In fact, if there was no greenhouse effect at all, the temperature of Earth would be something like more than 30 degrees Celsius lower than its natural condition. Today, the temperature of Earth on average is around 14 Celsius. So average global temperature is about 14 Celsius. In the past 150 years, it has increased about 1 degree. On the other hand, if there was not greenhouse effect, the temperature would be around minus 18. So it is a natural phenomenon, which is indeed beneficial for nature. And then it is emphasized, it is accelerated by the human emission of CO2 into the atmosphere. So, what is the human influence on that? So humans emit CO2, like any living species emits CO2. In order to understand what is the contribution of humans, we also have to consider that humans, with respect to other living species, they contribute to CO2 emissions in a more prominent way, because humans, as you know, started about 150 years ago to use fossil fuels for producing energy for many reasons. What are fossil fuels? Fossil fuels are derived from the decomposition of ancient organic matter. Which means organic matter means carbon. So the vegetation contains carbon because the vegetation absorbs carbon from the atmosphere and then keeps this carbon in its body. And when the vegetation dies, the carbon goes into the soil, over the soil, and by decomposition, they originate gases and oil, and the remains of this vegetation from the past, which was included in the body of the earth, creates the deposits of fossil fuels, which are deposits of carbon. So humans started to take this carbon from the underground and fueling it, burning it, which means release of CO2 in the atmosphere. So it is clear that the humans accelerated the carbon cycle. I want to give you, to show you a picture of the carbon cycle, which I can get from another lecture. Give me one second. So let me go here. Because I am teaching climate change in another course, it's a soft skill one. One second here. And here I have a picture of, give me some time, of the carbon cycle. Okay, it's the Earth system. This is the carbon cycle. And in this figure, you see that it is emphasized the role of humans. Perhaps it's overly emphasized because there is also a significant role of vegetation, oceans, in storing part of the carbon and releasing part of the carbon. In particular, it's not depicted here. The ocean has a great carbon sink, which means it's a deposit of carbon. The oceans absorb carbon from the atmosphere, which increases their acidification, and the level, the extent, the storage capacity of the oceans is governed by temperature. The cooler the ocean and the highest the storage, which means that if we increase the temperature of the oceans react by releasing carbon. And another sink of carbon is given by the fossil fuels, which are sinks of carbon within the body of the Earth, which humans tend to extract and release into the atmosphere. It is not easy, also for the carbon cycle, to put numbers here. There are estimates. There are estimates also of the human contribution, but these estimates are highly uncertain. So we don't have the capability to quantify in detail these fluxes of carbon, including the human contribution. I can tell you that there is a strong human contribution through agriculture, because agriculture is contributing to a lot of CO2 emissions, more than the CO2 emissions related to transportation, for instance. And this is why we emphasize today the need for also a change in our dietary uses, because producing meat, for instance, is the production of meat is a great contribution to the release of CO2. I go back to the PowerPoint presentation. Okay, so this is the greenhouse effect, which we think probably originated the so-called global warming. And the global warming is the expression that we use to identify an increase of temperature, of global temperature over the Earth, which occurred, we think, starting around 1750, around 1750, we will see some graphs of temperature reconstructed for the far past, and then it steadily kept increasing with some up and downs, but with a steady increase up to today. When we talk about the global warming period, usually we refer to the past 30 years from 1990, because in the past 30 years we observed an acceleration of the warming. This figure that you can see here is from the NASA. I think they also make available today an update. It provides a reconstruction of how global temperature has increased since 1950 up to 2013. I think there are now updates of this figure, which is today 10 years old. Here you can see there is the color scale on the left, which means that this is temperature increase. Where you see white, it's no change. Where you see yellow, let's say dark yellow, is about 1 degree of change. And where you see the dark red is about 2 degrees. And when you see blue, blue is a decrease of which is varying from zero, of course, to I would say -2, but I don't think we can see a -2 here. What you can see from this figure is that the increase of temperature is not homogeneous in space. There are hot spots. And in particular, you see an hot spot over Europe. And you see that the northern hemisphere has warmed up more than the southern hemisphere. This reconstruction is based on ground data and for the last period, for the past 30 years, is also based on satellite data. Of course, this change in measuring instruments may cause some also inhomogeneity in along the observation period of the observations, because ground measurements in the southern hemisphere are very few, and the density of the measurements in the southern hemisphere is very low, and of course there might be some bias, but the picture gives an idea of what occurred. This is global warming, and again we say, when we say global warming, we say from 1990 in this figure, which I cannot stop, the animation, but if it was slower, you could see that up to 1990, you don't see much red. After 1990, it's increased a lot. Okay, so other facts and a more quantitative definition of global warming. First, glaciers speak for themselves, so there is no absolutely no doubt on the fact that we are in a warming period, which started, by the way, around, as I said, 1750. In fact, you see here a picture, the first, the pictures on the left, the upper one and the middle one. You see that even from 1900 to 1960, there was a big change. And so already there, already in that time, when the CO2 concentration in the atmosphere was not so high as it is today. Actually, we say, I think I need to be more detailed on the period, we say that the warming started around 1750, but we have temperature measurements, enough temperature measurements, only from 1850. So we can describe global temperature with some reliability after 1850. Before the 1850, it's more reconstruction than direct observations. How do we reconstruct? We reconstruct, I go back to the other lecture, we reconstruct with this data. Just 1 second, it's not here. So let me select another one. Let me see. Okay. We reconstruct the past climate with this data. Just 1 second, I need to move forward here. I just want to show you a slide. It's not here. Give me one more second. So, okay, should be here. Let's see if I can well remember. Yeah, with this data, three rings. Okay, three rings, as you may have heard, they are called proxy data. Proxy means that they are not temperature observations, but by looking at how much a tree grew up during a year, we can find an indication, a proxy information, of temperature in that year. And another example of proxy data is the ice core. through the ice cores, which are ice currents, typically from the poles, we can reconstruct the past climate, because we can see the content of dust in the atmosphere and the content of isotopes, which are markers of time. We can see, basically, we can reconstruct some climatic behaviors through some components of the ice cores. So, as I said, we start from 1850 with measurements. So when we say instrumental period related to climate, we mean from 1850 to today. So let's look at the graph on the right here. You see that it starts from 1880. The reason is that given that they want to present here a moving average, which is the red line, they need to start a bit later with respect to 1850. I think this is the reason. This graph is, you can find updated. For instance, let's look at this one here. Let's give the time to open it. This is an update which goes up to more or less today. And this is monthly temperature. It starts from, I think it's, let's see, 1880, the same thing. And probably the reason why they start from 1880 is the coverage of stations. Some stations go back more in the past, but probably they wanted to start with the minimum coverage. And then you can see the progress up to today. So let's see, these are monthly data, so you see they are more variable. But let's have a look at the general behavior of this graph. From 1880, you have a first period, which is about constant, about stationary, with probably a bit of a decrease. And then in around 1930, there is a period of warming up to around 1950. And then there is a period of cooling. What you see at zero is the global average, okay? The global average in the long time. So here you see a cooling up to 1977, and then the last period of the global warming. During this period of the global warming, you see here a kind of stabilization from 2004 to 2014, more or less. During this period, we were hopeful that the increase was stabilizing, but then we had a sharp increase from 12-14 to 12-16, and then there is a situation that is fairly stabilized again in the past 7 years. Of course, it is difficult to try to draw conclusions. Now we are not much hopeful that it will be continue to stabilize, because the picture it's quite clear. By the way, I want to give you to draw your attention on this website, Our World in Data. It provides a lot of data. On not only climate, also on demography, which is also very important in order to make an assessment of sustainability, and also level of democracy. And so they classify the countries based on their level of level of democracy. And it is indeed interesting. These are free data. They also give numbers, and then it's possible to download. And it's interesting, if you look at the northern hemisphere and then the southern hemisphere, you see the difference. There is indeed a difference. In the past, it was it's more stable. In the past, it was warmer. And now it's cooler, it's more stable, even if the global behavior is more or less the same. But if you see the increase let's look at the order of magnitude. If zero is the long-term average, now we are about 1.3 degrees above. Let's look at the world. And let me just be more precise on what is shown here. So it's given as the deviation from the mean 1951-1980. So the zero is the mean 1951-1980, okay? So let's look at the order of magnitude. Here we are at about 0.87. Let's go here, the max, more or less. Okay, this is one, more or less. But here we are about minus two below. So the global warming, it's more or less plus one, plus 1.3. This is the order of magnitude. It's important that you get this perception because it's not clear in the public. Some people believe that the warming, the temperature has increased much more. And be careful about the hotspots. The Alps are an hotspot. The temperature increase in the Alps has been about 2 degrees. It's not quite clear why, but it has been about 2 degrees. Maybe that the reduction of the extension of the snowpack is playing also a role. Okay, so let's close this and let's go once again at the PowerPoint. So this is global warming, and you see here the order of magnitude is more or less the same, from minus 0.2 to plus 1. This is stopping at 2000, I think. This is 2010, so 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 2017. Okay, now, this is the situation about global warming. Now let's have a look at climatic variability, at climate variability, natural variability. So let's start with the big zoom. This is a zoom on the changes of temperature over the Earth in the past about 500 million years, which is, it's a long period. We will see zooms. Zero is today. You don't see the increase, the recent increase due to global warming, because you have to zoom in the very small part here, and these two curves are moving averages. I think the blue one is a moving average, which is extended over a window of 5 million years, and the black one, the windows, is 25 million. So you understand the moving average. It means that you are not looking at the value of each individual here, also because the proxy data wouldn't allow you to get the data at this solution. You are looking at the average over a window that is 25 million here, and you move this window over time. So basically, you can't see the recent changes. It's impossible because it's averaged out. And what you can see here is the glaciation, the glacial periods and the hot period. This is based on a reconstruction of an isotope, an oxygen isotope. Let's forget about the details. I just want to say that when you, in terms of difference in temperature between this point here and this point here, there is probably something like at least 30 degrees of global temperature, which means a huge variation. We don't have an explanation for this cyclical variability of climate. And there are several possible explanations, from volcanic eruptions to, the impact of asteroids, other causes which may also be given by big earthquakes, very big earthquakes with the release of dust in the atmosphere, which causes a cooling down. So, and changes in solar activity. This may be also a cause, because we don't have much knowledge over on the solar activity in the long term. We have some knowledge on the short-term cycles of the solar activity, but not on the changes in the long term. Okay, one thing that most of the persons don't know, if you look here. We are in a glaciation now. We are in the quaternary glaciation. Here there is a link where we can see it that is currently ongoing, okay? And what is interesting is that during a glaciation, we have an alternation of glacial and interglacial periods. So during a glaciation, you have up and downs. So the quaternary glaciation is ongoing, but we are in an interglacial period. So we are now in an up. Let me say something more about this with the next slide. This is a zoom. Remember, the past one was 500 million years. Now it's 500,000, okay? And here you can see that this is temperature, the upper one. You can see that about 15,000 years ago, temperature increased. How much? About 8 degrees. So now this is the zero now. It's zero is the current average. And we started from 15,000 years ago from minus 8. But we are still in the down. And so you understand that a change of minus 8 is a big change. It's a change that caused, for instance, the glaciers in Italy from the Alps to reach the flat region of where we are now. So up to Verona, glaciers got to Verona, more or less. And the sea level was about 120 meters lower than now. And this with a temperature change of about 8 degrees. If you go back here, you see that the temperature change is during a glaciation and during a hot period and a cold period is much higher. And therefore, this is why I talked about at least 30 degrees, maybe also some more. I'm sorry. Now, what is interesting to notice here is the correlation between the CO2 concentration in the atmosphere and temperature, and also the concentration, the dust concentration and its relationship with the temperature. Now, there is a strong correlation between temperature and carbon dioxide. This is a known result. And this correlation is due to the presence of links and feedbacks between these two variables, meaning that we already know that the greenhouse effect causes a temperature increase if the CO2 concentration is increased. Then, what happens is that a temperature increase in turn implies an increase of the temperature of the ocean with some delay, and then an increase of CO2 emission from the oceans. So there is a two ways interaction between temperature and carbon. And it's not easy to say, it's like a chicken and egg question. It's not easy to say who started first. And it is quite possible that in some of these peaks, the carbon anticipated temperature, in other peaks, temperature anticipated carbon, because if temperature changed for a change in the solar activity, this would cause an increase of CO2, which in turn stimulates another increase of temperature. This is a negative feedback. So it is not easy to say who started first, and the scientific literature is debating on this a lot, because you understand that this is very relevant in terms of climate change attribution, because, the greenhouse theory relies on the assumption that a perturbation of CO2 causes a perturbation of temperature, which is certainly true. But it may also be that this is not very significant. because it may be that the correlation is given by the feedback of the oceans, which may be much higher. We cannot really quantify these fluxes. So the scientific literature is debating a lot, but I don't think it is a relevant debate for an engineer. It is important to establish to what extent is natural variability and to what extent is human impact. It is important, but for an engineer, what is important is to find solutions to a problem that now it exists, because we have a difficult relationship with climate today, clearly. And therefore, I don't think, I'm not very passionate about this debate. In terms of dust, an increase of dust concentration should cause a cooling of the Earth. In fact, you see that there is a weak correspondence between the down of temperature and the ups of dust concentration. Dust concentration, you may remember the recent eruption of the volcano, I don't remember the name, I think it was in Finland or in Norway some years ago, which caused a decrease in temperature, which lasted for about, I think, 2-3 years. Anyway, let's zoom even more. This is a focus on the past 2,000 years. And this is nice because it allows to show the natural variability in the short term. And what you can see here is the identification of the so-called medieval warm period and the Little Ice Age. We don't know the causes for these up and downs, which occurred quite recently. We know for some oral traditions that during the Roman Empire, there was a climatic optimum in Europe. There are several oral witnesses of the fact that climate and the extension of glaciers, for instance, in the Alps, was lower than today. We also have some notes from monasteries, from monks, which testify the presence of the medieval warmer period. It was a climate optimum. And it is not clear if this climate optimum was global or only European, because we have these notes from the monks only from Europe. We also know very well about the Little Ice Age that caused an extension of the snowpack, and the presence of permanent glaciers also extended over the Apennines. We have several memories of scientists who observed the permanent presence of snow over areas in the Apennine that today don't receive any snow, even during winter, most frequently. The Little Ice Age ended around 1750. As I said, the causes of these events are not clear, of these fluctuations, long-term ones, because you see we are talking about a decrease of temperature that lasted for about 500 years. What is interesting to see is that there were several studies proving that during the warm period, the welfare of society was higher than during the cool periods. And during the cool periods, there was an increase, at least in Europe, of the frequency of floods. So if you look at, also in Wikipedia, there are some list of floods for the Tever River, for the Po River, for the Arno River, and other rivers in Europe. And it is clear the link between the cooling and the disasters. And it's clear the link between the warming and the prosperity. Of course, it depends also on the local conditions. For instance, if you think at the current condition of Europe, it is clear that probably a warming would produce more benefit in the north of Europe, but in the south of Europe, where we have little water and where we already suffer from high temperature, water scarcity, the opposite will happen. But on average, it is interesting to notice the association between floods and temperature, which apparently wouldn't justify the current feeling that floods increased under global warming. On the other hand, there is to say, and this is something that it is subtle but very interesting, there is to say that the reports from the past that we receive about floods are referred to huge floods. Huge floods means big rivers. So we have reports for the Arno, as I said, for the Tevere, for the Adige, for the Po, the big rivers of Italy. We don't have reports for the small torrents, for the creeks. But actually, if you think at the current situation in terms of flood frequency, most of the floods are caused today by small rivers, not big ones. So if you look at the Po River in the past 20 years, there was no flood. No problem. And also in the Adige, in the Arno, in the Tevere, no problem. Which means that maybe that there is a complicated association between the increase of temperature and the scale of the flood. So an increase of temperature may not cause any problem for the big floods, but may cause problems for the small floods. I will explain to you later why, because of course, the first question would be why small floods are more sensitive to warming with respect to big floods. I'm postponing this discussion. Anyway, now let's. I already discussed about this, but there is one thing that I wanted to emphasize here. What happens with a warming atmosphere? With a warming atmosphere, it happens that there is an increase, a corresponding increase of the water retention capacity, water vapor retention capacity of the atmosphere, because a warmer atmosphere can retain more water. So it means that a warmer atmosphere sets the basis for a transfer of water from the Earth to the atmosphere, which means that rainfall is more likely because you have more water there. And how much is this increase? The Clausius-Clapeyron equation tells us that for each degree of increase, the atmosphere at saturation, this is extremely important, at saturation can retain about 6-7% more water. So under global warming, we had an increase of 1 degree, which means that in the atmosphere at saturation, we have, after global warming, 7% more water. Now, why I stressed at saturation? Because water capacity at saturation is not water content. The actual water content also depends on evaporation. If you don't have evaporation, the atmosphere is dry, even if the retention capacity is potentially higher. So it's not given for granted that under global warming we have more evaporation. And we will see that indeed observations tell us the opposite. On the other hand, let's assume that we have indeed more water in the atmosphere. If you have more water, you should expect more rainfall. And in particular, you may expect that the more rainfall is concentrated in the warm periods, which means that you may have, for instance, let's refer to Italy, during summer, more rainfall. But summer rainfall is in the form of short duration storms, typically. It's thunderstorms. If you think of the typical storms during summer, they are flash ones. Like they last for 10 minutes, 5 minutes. During winter, you have rainfall that may last for a couple of weeks. Okay, this is important to keep in mind. Because now I am introducing the next step, which is, okay, increasing temperature is a fact, but temperature doesn't impact us directly. It impacts us through water. through the mediation, through the filter of water. So now the question is, after warming, what happens to rainfall? And this is why I made this reasoning, because rainfall is in turn governing water resources and water threats. So flooding, drought, water threats and water resources. Rainfall is governing storage and water flow over the earth. Okay, so let's take into account this reasoning that we did. And one more thing, because we passed the analysis of rainfall. Keep in mind that when we want to assess climate change, we have two main routes to do that, two main ways. The first way is to look at data. So we saw some graphs of temperature, progress of temperature during time. We look at the data. This is called inductive approach. So you look at the results, and from the results, you reconstruct, you go back to the state of the system. So a change in temperature is identified as a change in the state of the system. But we have another way, which has been invented because we don't have much observations. And the other way is to describe with a model the system and to see how the results of the model change. For instance, I increase the CO2 in the atmosphere in the model and I look at the increase in temperature. This is called a deductive approach. Both approaches have pros and cons. The benefit of the inductive approach is that data are more reliable than a model. But the disadvantage is that data, we don't have many of them. We don't have an extension of our database that is large enough to cover spatial variability and temporal variability. So this is a bit of a problem, and this is why we decide to use models. The important thing for you is that when you get information about climate change, you should also be fully aware of the nature of that information. Is that derived from a model or from data? This is essential, because most of the information about climate change comes from models, especially the future predictions. We don't have data into the future. So most of it comes from model, but it is not told. And, you know, models, as I said, with respect to data, as an engineer, I would say that I prefer to use observed numbers rather than modeling results as an engineer. When you talk to a pure scientist may say the opposite with respect to me, like, yeah, but data are sparse, data are uncertain, while the model is something that I can better control, I better understand, which it's a point of view that I understand. On the other hand, you know, we have to be fully aware of the difference in information content of these two types of information. So this is something that I highly recommend. Okay, now, rainfall. So first of all, let's look at precipitation, distribution of precipitation over the Earth. And this is a distribution of monthly precipitation. Why it's important? It's important to get a picture of spatial variability of precipitation. And then the distribution of precipitation. And it's important also to get an order of magnitude. So the color scale is hardly legible. I can tell you that where you see the dark blue is about 2.5 meters of rainfall in a year, which means that if I put a tank outside with no evaporation, I put the tank on the 1st of January, and then I go there after 365 days, I measure the depth of water, This is annual precipitation. And in the places where it is highest, it's about 2.5 meters. In Bologna is about 700 millimeters, 0.7 meters. In the rainiest point of Italy, which is in the Friuli region, it's about 2.5 meters. But they are very, very wet spots. It is important to look at the distribution because where there is more rainfall, there are more water resources. So significant to see that over Europe, over the north of Europe, we are close to blue, and over almost the whole of Europe, we are in the green area. The green area means that it's fine. I mean, with 1 meter of precipitation per year, it's a good condition. This is important because water cannot be easily moved. So if there is enough water for everybody over the earth, and I mean, also if we think of a huge and further demographic expansion, there is water enough for everybody. It's not a problem, fresh water enough, even without desalination. The problem is the distribution, because it's not easy to move water. We are talking about huge volumes. It's not like gases or oil. When we talk about oil, it's a reduced volume. Gas, you can move the gas, you know, we know this, from Russia to Europe with a small pipe. It's fine. Water, moving water, it's not possible. It's not possible. You would need too much energy. The pipes would need to be very large. So the uneven distribution of water is indeed a problem. And therefore, if you think of changes, you understand where they be more problematic. If you look at the area that are green, they can become white. Okay, here you see a mention to the evaporation paradox. I want to mention it to you. We would expect that under global warming, evaporation increases, as I said. Actually, we have measures of pan evaporation around the world, which tell us that, on the contrary, after global warming, pan evaporation is decreased. What is pan evaporation? It's evaporation from the evaporimeter. It's a tool like a tank, which is filled up with water, and then we measure evaporation by looking at the decrease of the water depth into the tank. So this is pan evaporation, and it is decreased. So what could be the explanation? A possible explanation is not shown here, is that wind has decreased in strength, because climate models also predict wind, so they can also predict the change on wave dynamics. So one possible explanation is a loss of strength of the wind. Evaporation depends a lot on wind velocity, because if the atmosphere gets saturated after evaporation, evaporation stops. And if the air is in a steady condition with no movement, then saturation is reached around the evaporimeter quite quickly. So, I mean, it depends on wind. If there is wind that is bringing the wet air away, then evaporation starts again and keeps going. If there is no wind, you have no evaporation when you reach saturation. So this is a first explanation, a decrease of the wind velocity, of the global wind velocity. A second possible explanation is that you have a general increase of evaporation from the ground, and therefore also around the evaporimeter, you have an increased evaporation, which may cause a decrease of evaporation from the evaporimeter. This looks less credible to me, but it's an explanation. And another explanation is the increase in cloud coverage. We don't have observation of changes in cloud coverage. may be that an increased temperature has caused an increased evaporation and then an increase in the extension of clouds, which act as a screen against the solar radiation. This is a kind of a positive feedback. After a warming, the system may react by building a screen against further warming, which is possible. It is possible because the Earth system is resilient. Anyway, this is the evaporation paradox, which means that we are not sure, actually, that the water content in the atmosphere is increased. So the question is rainfall changed or not? And then we come to measurements. So first of all, let me show you a very important piece of information. In Bologna, we have one of the longest rainfall series in the world, and it's daily observations. Here you see the annual rainfall, but actually they are daily observations. And you see that it starts from 1813, so it's really a long period. Here you see data up to, I think, 2019. So it's more than 200 years, actually. And you see that the progress in time is opening some question marks. First of all, you don't see a clear trend. And I anticipate that when we talk about long-term rainfall, annual rainfall is defined as a long-term rainfall. It's a statistic computer over a time window, which is 1 year long. We don't see at the global level a significant change in precipitation, neither declining or increasing. Of course, there are some differences depending on the location. In some locations, we see a light decrease, and in other locations, a light increase. But on average, what we can see here is the picture that we can observe in several other locations. And what we can instead observe here, which is very interesting, is the presence of cycles. And they are marked in gray for the cycles of water scarcity, of precipitation scarcity. And what's interesting is that in the past, it looks like we had more droughts because water precipitation scarcity means a meteorological drought, means less precipitation. We had in the past apparently higher frequency of long-term droughts. And these long-term droughts are a bit concerning. I will say something more soon. So in the first period, we see some apparent droughts that lasted for a long time. And we see another drought in around the Second World War, from 1940, started before the 1940, started about 1910, and lasted for several years. In particular, from 1944 to 1950, it was very long, 6 years, and very, very intensive. As you can see here, there is, I put the mouse, is this one? No, it's, sorry, it's this one. Yeah, this one. This was quite long, and in terms of deficit was quite intensive. Not the most intensive, because this one from 1920 to 1930 was also very, very important, and also this one in 1800. And in the recent past, we didn't observe these long-term periods with so scarce rainfall. So this opens the door to several conclusions, several further questions. And the first one is, did global warming maybe acted as a mitigation of the drought risk? I wouldn't say that. I wouldn't say that global warming changed the dynamics to this extent. Yes, one may say more evaporation, more rainfall, but I don't think that cycles are influenced by global warming. So I would say that the drought risk that we observed in 1940 is the same drought risk that we have today. And second question, is this given by an anomaly in Bologna? So we got the series in Milan, an analogous series in Milan, which confirms that between 1940 and 1950 there was a dry period also in Milan. And also it is confirmed because there are several confirmations from memories in Italy of the severity of this drought. We don't know if it was a European one, but for sure, or we should make other investigations on that. But for sure, it has been extended over Italy. So another consideration: what if a drought like that one of the 1940s occurred today? It would be a drama because it would be dramatic because. The impact would be much higher. We have water demands today and a socio-economic context that is more vulnerable to this kind of risk. So what I concluded with, I had a meeting with, because you know, today droughts are a very relevant issue, you know why. So yesterday our prime minister announced that they are nominating a commission to deal with the current droughts. The current droughts started in 2021, and then in 2022 was particularly important, and still going. If you look at the levels of the Po River, the levels of the Alpine lakes, also there is a report of the Joint Research Center of the European Union issued 1 week ago, and they are much concerned because it looks like it's a long-term drought. Keep in mind, drought cannot be predicted, so it may be that in 1 week from now it starts raining and rains for 2 months. So we don't have the capability to make a reliable seasonal prediction. We can make meteorological prediction with an horizon of a couple of weeks. But after 2 weeks, we are unable to make predictions. On the other hand, we cannot ignore the fact that in the past, this is what I reported, I said, we cannot ignore that only 8 years ago, we had a period of 5 years with minus 20% precipitation on average, with peaks of minus 40% per year. So we cannot ignore this. If it occurred 8 years ago, it can occur today. And we have no reasons for saying that global warming has mitigated the risk. We have reasons to say that the current evolution, the current context is more vulnerable. So we cannot ignore this. Also, if we look internationally, there were several droughts that occurred in Australia from 2001 to 2010, in California from 2013 to 2017, in South Africa from 2015 to 2019, several episodes of long-term droughts, which lasted for like 5 years, which caused several problems. So indeed, the current situation is concerning. Maybe that as I said, in 2 weeks it starts raining, but we are not sure, and I would say it's unlikely that we reach a compensation in the short period, and therefore we have to get prepared, okay? Okay, let's move forward. Another thing. This is drought, this is floods, meaning that this is high precipitation. It looks complicated, but it's not. This is another study that we did in Bologna. We analyzed daily precipitation. So in this case here, it was annual precipitation. Here is daily precipitation. And let's forget about the animation. We took into account, we considered about 68,000 records of daily rainfall with a duration of at least 50 years for the period 1960-2010. And the distribution of the rainfall station is what you can see in the map of the globe. Forget about the animation for now. And the animation instead tells you the changes in frequency. The changes in frequency, which if you look at the animated graph, changes in frequency of what? Of extreme events above a threshold, like when the daily rainfall exceeded a given threshold, which we defined as an extreme, we counted the event. And then we estimate the frequency. So if you look at the animated graph on the upper part left of this slide, you see the progress in time of changes in frequency. There is an increase. This is a global figure. There is an increase of frequency of extremes in the period, which is not very relevant, is about plus 20%. So you may say, yeah, but it's relevant, plus 20%. But actually, plus 20%, it means that if you had an extreme rainfall per year in a location, now you have 1.2. It's not changing much, actually. But on the other hand, the important conclusion is it looks like the long-term precipitation is not influenced by warming. The short-term precipitation looks influenced. And this is connected to what I anticipated, like you have more water, you should have more precipitation during summer. Summer, the precipitation is a short-term one. In fact, there is the feeling that the precipitation that has a duration, very short one, like a few minutes, is increased, while the long-term precipitation is substantially, in essence, unchanged. On the right, you see the same graph as in the upper left, but referred to the whole globe, the upper one. Northern hemisphere, it's the second one from the top. And then you have a focus on northern western hemisphere, third one, northern eastern hemisphere, fourth one. There are no big changes. What we can see is that indeed the northern hemisphere is the one who suffers more. Keep in mind that the coverage of the station, as you see, there are only few in Australia, basically, in the southern hemisphere. So, keep in mind, changes in extreme precipitation, short-term duration, because this is connected to further consideration that I will make later. Now, let's shift over sea level. Okay, before going to the sea level, I just want to, do you have any question? Okay, so I think we can make the break now. I am 5 minutes earlier, but I prefer to make the break before starting with the sea level, so we don't have to interrupt in between. Thank you.
Okay, prof. See you later.
See you later in 15 minutes. Grazie. Okay. Start again. So, sea level. This is clearly relevant to us. So let's first look as we did for temperature. Let's look at a big picture, a big zoom, by looking at this graph, which shows the progress of sea level starting from about 25,000 years ago. A very similar picture is reported in the next slide. I show it to you. Let's look at the picture in the upper part of the slide. And there is some more information which is related to naming some relevant time periods. Let's look back at this figure here, where you can see the indication of the places where the level has been recorded and through proxy data. And you can look at the order of magnitude of the sea level rise. As I said, if we indicate with zero the current level, is the sea level rise in the considered time span is about 120 meters, which is something that can be explained, of course, by the increase of temperature that started during the start, since the start of the last interglacial period. You can see about the increase started about 14,000 years ago, as I anticipated. And it corresponds to an increase in temperature, you may remember, of about 8 degrees. So the order of magnitude is 120 meters of sea level per 8 degrees of increase of temperature, which means more or less for each degree is about 10 meters, which, as you will see, doesn't correspond to what we recently observed. But of course, the scale is different. Now, you don't have to be surprised. 120 meters of sea level change is also what we know from our knowledge of the past in this region here. On the other hand, keep in mind that we think of the sea level as something that is constant over the globe. It's not. There are minor changes from one location to another due to tides, due to the presence of wind, due to the movement in general of water, and changes in the forcing. In any case, the differences are minor, not comparable with the order of magnitude of change that you see here. Now, let's focus on the causes of this sea level rise, which is due part to thermal expansion and part to release of ice, of water from ice caps and glaciers. You will see that if we focus on the recent period, and it's not in this figure, but it's in the next figures, but you will see that if we focus on the recent period, and recent I mean, let's say between, it's written here, 1900 and 2016, the sea level change, the sea level rise is varying from 16 to 21 centimeters. And data from satellite radar measurements show an accelerating rise of about 7 centimeters from 1993 to 2017, which is coherent with the pace of global warming. Now, in this range of change, so about 15 centimeters, we can say that about half of it is due to melting of glaciers, and half of it is due to thermal expansion. Now, global warming is about 1 degree of change. There is to say that the sea level rise may be delayed after after global warming. So this is something that is to be kept into account. Now, in the next slide, besides the figure which is related to the sea level rise, we can see a map produced by the NASA again, which shows under the hypothesis of an increase of sea level of 6 meters, so well beyond what we have observed during global warming, shows in red the pixels of the area that could be flooded. These areas, you may think that they are limited. On the other hand, you should keep into account that there are hotspots, like if you look at Indonesia, it's clear that there are hotspots. And second, keep in mind what we know very well, which is the importance of coastal areas for, in terms of number of people living there, about 40%, you may remember, of the total human population is within 100 meters elevation from the sea, and the importance of coastal areas for the socioeconomic context. So, I mean, if we got flooding in these areas, it would be really something really concerning. But on the other hand, this map is for 6 meters. So let's keep it into account. Because now what we have to focus on is, indeed, what we observe during global warming and whether, to what extent this is significant. So we are talking from about 1900, we are talking of arrays of about 15 centimeters, which means, you know, which means something that is not very relevant. On the other hand, keep in mind that this is global average of sea level rise. There are hotspots with not big changes anyway. And let's also consider that this is just an indication of mean sea level. It doesn't mean that the max height of the wave is increased of the same quantity, 15 centimeters. This is related to something different. It's related also to changes in wind. And another consideration, keep in mind that in terms, you may say, in Italy it's not a problem. I mean, in Italy, 15 centimeters, even if one added something like one more half a meter, wouldn't be a big problem. On the other hand, okay, maybe in Venice. In Venice it is a problem. In Venice I think it's already a problem, 15 centimeters. On the other hand, in terms of saltwater intrusion, 15 centimeters are a huge matter. It's a huge change, because you may remember that given that saltwater is heavier, in terms of saltwater intrusion, even a small change in mean sea level means a lot of change in terms of extension of the saltwater wedge into the land. So we just have to take into account not only coastal flooding. Coastal flooding is one of the reasons of concern, but if we look at Italy, maybe that it is more concerning the saltwater intrusion rather than the coastal flooding. Another consideration on this figure, it looks like during global warming, the pace is not increased much. It looks a little bit increased, especially if you look at the red line. The red line is satellite measurements. Satellite measurements of sea level started in 1993. So this is the reason why you see a short red line. If you look at this short red line, it looks like indeed the pace, it is very, very small, but if we look at the details, somewhere it's written in some of the slides, it's written here. If you look at the details, indeed, the details show a slight increase under global warming in the past 30 years. Second, there is to say that, yes, the pace looks quite constant, not increased. Also, If you look from 1940 to 1960, you see, and also from 1920 to 1940, I mean, from 1930 to 1940, you see a big slope, an increasing slope. So there are changes in slope. On the other hand, we have always to keep in mind that it may be delayed, the effect. So maybe that the effect of global warming is not much visible because it may be delayed, okay? Now, another consideration, which is written here on the left. There is a very nice monograph on sea level rise on the website of Judith Curry, which is linked here. And let's see if we open it. I think, let's see where it is. Not here, so. Because I have more than one. Okay, it's not here. Let me check. Ah, okay, yes, I need to open. Okay, this is a special report by Judith Curry in 2018, Sea Level and Climate Change. I found it very useful. And it is very comprehensive, and I think it is an objective analysis. Look, Judith Curry, she's considered a climate skeptic. I think you know what climate skeptic means. It means that this term is misused to indicate the scientist that, to classify and categorize the scientist who are not very convinced by the human influence on climate. And I don't think it is, I don't think it is a proper way of categorizing people, but in any case, I think the term with Judith Curry is particularly misused, because I think she's presenting an objective series of facts. And I must say that from a technical point of view, I found this report and the information in the website overall very useful. And she's now working as a research consultant. And indeed, I think I can recognize the very practical way of trying to quantify the process, try to quantify the information. Okay, let's go back to our presentation. To quote Judith Curry, which reports another quote of another scientist, Hubert Lamb, which I think is interesting. The water level may have dropped by 2 meters of, or more between 2000 before Christ and 500. What does seem certain is that there was a tendency for world sea level rise to rise progressively during the time of the Roman Empire, finally reaching a high stand around 400 after Domine, comparable with or slightly above present. So, I mean, there are changes. These changes may coincide with the climate optimum. So during the Roman Empire, there was a climate optimum, as I mentioned to you. And actually, these changes also occurred recently, because the current sea level rise started very early, as you see, from 1880. So the start of this rise is not justified by the increase in CO2 emissions. Let's have a look at a very large zoom from 1993 to today. And here we have a quote from the IPCC. The IPCC, if we want to adopt the previous classification, is providing the opposite opinion, the opposite interpretation on the attribution of climate change. The IPCC is reflecting the mainstream, the opinion of most of the scientists, that climate change is indeed human-induced and dominates, the human effect dominates with respect to natural variability. And they conclude that it's very likely that the mean rate of global average sea level rise was 1.7, millimeter per year between 1901 and 2010, and 3.2, so more than, it's about twice, from 1993 to 2010. It's likely that similar high rates occurred between 1920 and 1950. So, I mean, there are cyclical behavior. However, let's keep into account the order of magnitude. Let's focus on the order of magnitude, which is important to try to understand what may happen in the future. Because in the future, now we will see predictions of future increase of temperature and corresponding predictions of future increase of sea level. Now, first, let's keep into account that these cycles in sea levels, what could be the explanation? These cycles beyond the effect of temperature, what could be the explanation? And it is important to investigate the drivers if we want to make predictions, because predictions cannot be based only, as we have seen, on the increase of temperature, because there is not a perfect correspondence between the observed past temperature increases and increases in sea level. So, another possible explanation for the changes in sea level may be the presence of climate cycles like El Niño Southern Oscillation, the ENSO, the El Niño. What is El Niño? El Niño is caused, let's look at the Pacific Ocean, it's caused by a difference in temperature between the east of the Pacific Ocean. The east of the Pacific Ocean is South America, and difference in temperature between the east and the west of the Pacific Ocean. This means that if there is a difference, let's say, the Pacific Ocean is warmer close to South America and cooler close to Australia, we have several effects, several consequences. Two of them, let's mention them. Where there is a warmer ocean, you have more evaporation and a wetter climate. Where there is cool ocean, you have dry conditions, less evaporation, dry conditions. So El Niño is precisely identified as a warmer Pacific close to South America than close to Australia, which means a lot of rain over South America, floods, excess of rain, and droughts in Australia. The opposite situation is called La Niña. La Niña means droughts in South America, floods in Australia. The effect is not limited to South America and Australia. It's also extended over Europe with a weaker intensity. The duration of El Niño and La Niña is from two to several years, and also the periodicity. It's varying from 2 to 7 years. These are cyclical behavior, but they cannot be predicted. They cannot be predicted with a given lead time. So it's difficult to make prediction of droughts in the future. And these cycles seems not to be related to global warming. At least a direct connection was not found. So we cannot say that El Niño intensify under global warming, La Niña intensify. We cannot say that. Another effect is a difference in level of the ocean, and therefore, you know, this may cause local sea level changes which may last for several years. Of course, we try to average over the global level, but there is indeed there might be some differences in global sea level depending on the location of the gorges due to these large-scale atmospheric patterns. Okay, now let's talk about predictions. And these are predictions which are derived through through climate models. So they are not really considering these effects due to El Niño, which I just mentioned. And these climate models predict changes in temperature, which you can see in the top part of this table, and changes in global mean sea level. This climate model refers to two periods. This is straightforward. You see first around 2050, and second around 2100. They also refer to different emission scenarios. This is something that I didn't mention today. What are emission scenarios? In order to make a prediction of the future climate, I need to make first a prediction of the human emissions of CO2. And these, of course, are uncertain. And in order to cope with this uncertainty, refers to several different hypotheses. The last one, RCP 8.5, is called business as usual, like it is assumed that the increase in CO2 concentration in the atmosphere will continue in the future as it raised in the past, with the same pace of increase. The business as usual, now the scientific community considers that it may be overly skeptical, overly pessimistic, over precautionary. And then if we go up in the table and down with the numbers from 8.5 to 6, 4.5 to 2.6, you get a corresponding decrease of future concentration of CO2. Let's say decrease of rate of decrease. Okay. Let's say a decrease in the rate of increase, so a mitigation of the human component in the future. 2.6 is considered overly optimistic, so not precautionary. The other ones are considered, in a way, something that may happen. But let's refer to 0.5. Let's refer to the most precautionary approach, which tells us that, and let's refer to 2100, tells us that the range of increase in temperature may be from 2.6 degrees to 4.8 in temperature. Keep in mind the target of the Paris Agreement. The target of the Paris Agreement was to limit the global warming to 1.5. Now we are at 1.3. Here, under RCP 8.5, it is predicted that it may range, it may reach 4.8. The Paris Agreement, the target would be met, almost met, by RCP 4.5, as you can see here. 1.8 it's close, it's a little bit higher than 1.5, but not much. In terms of sea level, you see that if we get the more precautionary prediction, is 0.82, 82 centimeters, which means that if you subtract 15, it's plus 0.6, 0.65 from now. This is the more pessimistic. So this is the range that you may expect. So in the 2100, with the more pessimistic value of the range and the more pessimistic emission scenario, we could get 60 centimeters more of sea level rise, which gives to you the order of magnitude of the concern. On the other hand, there is, by many of the scientists, a concern which is related to the uncertainty of these models, because these uncertainties could imply an underestimation. In particular, these models don't consider the possible tipping point. Tipping point means a threshold over which you have a sudden change in the dynamics of the system, and a change that is not easily cannot be easily reverted. So a tipping point is something where you might have a slight increase up to the tipping point and then an exponential increase. So these models don't consider a possible tipping point, which may be given by a sudden melt of the ice caps. And this may happen because we have reconstructed that in the past the Earth already experienced warm periods where the Earth didn't have any ice cap, didn't have any ice over the poles. This is known. What we don't know is how the melting occurred. Was it a sudden melting or a progressive one? We cannot exclude a relatively fast melting of the ice caps, because what may happen is that, let me make a premise. We recently discovered that below the ice caps, there are huge subglacial lakes, huge volumes of liquid water. Why liquid? Because the high pressure of the ice that is above keeps the water in liquid form. And these subglacial lakes have considerable volume. In fact, there are several research projects now financed for performing a careful monitoring to try to quantify how many of these lakes, the volume, to get an idea of the volume of these lakes. We also discovered that in some of these lakes, originated what are called subglacial floods, which means sudden releases of water into the ocean. Because it's clear, with the reduction of the extension of the ice cap, when you get the melting gets close to a lake, then there is a sudden release of the water into the lake, from the lake into the ocean. And we know that some of these sudden releases already occurred. And now we are trying with monitoring facilities, with cameras, also to observe some of these outbursts of water from the ice caps. So the question is, maybe that if we reach to a certain threshold in the reduction of the ice cap, then that we have sudden releases of the water from these lakes. And these are not considered by these models, by these predictions. So it may happen that you get a sudden increase of like 20 centimeters in 1 year. This is not really likely, but it is something that we cannot exclude. So the sense of the message that I want to deliver to you is we have this prediction. We can take the most pessimistic one. And indeed, I think that it is unlikely that we reach this level of rays. On the basis of our current knowledge, I would say if something really unexpected, unless it occurs something really unexpected, it is unlikely that we get these 82 centimeters in 2100 of sea level rise. But we don't have to forget the possibility that events with very low probability happen. And what is the conclusion of this message? The conclusion is that we should consider what would be the impact if something unexpected occurs, not only in terms of sea level rise, also in terms of flood, in terms of droughts, and ask the question of what if? And the conclusion may be, well, not a big issue. So I would say in Italy, in Venice may be an issue if we get an increase of sea level of 20 centimeters in 1 year. For the rest of Italy, okay, I don't want to be too hurried in my conclusion, but maybe that it's not a so big problem. But there might be some locations, Venice, for instance, where the consequences may be a huge damage, a huge impact in terms of economic costs or in terms of loss of lives. So where we see these conditions, where we see the conditions for an extremely huge impact for something that we consider not very likely, but still possible, you know, it's a different story. I'm saying this because our experience, our practical experience, suggests that we tend to exclude from the list of the possible events those that are less probable, those that are very unlikely. And I give you an example. The European Directive for Flood Protection suggests to design river flow flood protections for a retro period, which is at most, retro period, I think you know what it means, at most 300 years. Which means that we forget about events with a longer retro period. But what if a flood with 1,000 years retro period occurs? In some cases, the damage it would be more or less the same than a flood with a retro period of 300 years. So in these cases, it's completely justified that we forget about these very extreme events, because getting protected against them would cost so much that it's not worth considering. But if we see that the damage becomes 10 times higher for an event of retro period of 1,000 years with respect to an event with a retro period of 300, this means that we have to be concerned, that we have to consider a possible reaction that we may apply, a possible strategy that we may apply to manage with such an event. This is something that is usually not done. Usually we refer to guidelines, to law enforced, to regulations, and then we forget about what is not considered by the regulations. And the results are, I mean, I can give you some examples, like the drought in Germany that occurred in 2021. No, sorry, the flood in Germany in 2021, yes. This flood was really unexpected, really something, and killed a lot of people and caused a very relevant damage. And I think that the reason of this death and this damage is that it was just discarded, this possibility, this event was just not considered. So in our case, let's consider that the sea level increase may be higher than that. Maybe higher than that, and in most of the cases, it will not make a big difference. In most of the cases, will not make a big difference from 82 centimeters to 2 meters. In most of the cases, of course, there is a difference, but the difference in most of the cases would not be so dramatic. In other cases, maybe that even a difference of 20 centimeters more may cause a dramatic impact. And in these cases, I think we have to be careful. It is not easy because, as I said, there is convenience in neglecting the possibility of unlikely events. There is convenience. On the other hand, also because why there is convenience? There is convenience not only because the cost-benefit ratio is not favorable. If you also think at our current political system, it's based on democracy, which is perfect. I mean, democracy is not perfect, but it is what we think it's optimal. But democracy basically suggests that the length of the term of a politician is at most, maybe in some cases you may reach 10 years, 20 years, but it is unlikely. Usually there is rotation because democracy also benefits from rotation. Also our institutional arrangement benefits from rotation. It's different from dictatorship, where there is a lifetime a lifetime duration, which may become 50 years. If you think the Queen, okay, it's not a good example because the Queen in UK is not a dictatorship. But still, if you think of the Queen in UK, it's a nice example because it lasted. Elizabeth lasted for 70 years. So when you have a duration of your term that is 70 years, you have more convenience in accounting for events that are unlikely. When the duration of your term is 5 years, you don't have convenience because during 5 years, you may get safer with respect to something that will never happen in 5 years because it is very unlikely. On the other hand, it costs a lot during the 5 years because it's a social cost. So it's unpopular. It's unpopular for the duration of one term. And this is another reason why often we tend to discard the likelihood of these events. So I just talked a few minutes ago about the drought that we are experiencing now. We have the full convenience, the institution has the full convenience in assuming that it will not last much longer, but it will stop maybe in 2 weeks from now. There is no convenience by them to assume that it may last for 3 years more. There is no convenience. And this makes our role as advisors, as technicians, as engineers, more complicated. Because, you know, very often when we present our feeling, our suggestion not to discard events with very low likelihood, we are just neglected. Our interpretation is neglected because people say, okay, I understand, but I cannot be protected against everything. But it is an important consideration, I think. So this closes our treatment of sea level, and then let's look at floods. Now, first of all, to give you an idea, we have about a little bit less than 1 hour to go, and I aim to talk about flood, droughts, and then actions. So after the risk, actions. Floods. First, I mentioned to you that there might be a difference between large-scale floods and small-scale floods. So maybe that large-scale floods are not suffering from global warming. Why? Maybe that the opposite is true for small-scale floods. Why? Because the explanation is connected to the consideration that I made on long rainfall, short rainfall. So I said no changes in longer rainfall and possibly changes in short-term rainfall. Now, what is the most dangerous rainfall for a river? It is, I'm not providing any demonstration of that, but this is a well-known evidence. The critical rainfall for a river is the rainfall that lasts precisely the travel time of the river. So, if the river takes 1 day to get from the mountains to the closure, to the estuary or the delta, if it takes 1 day, the dangerous rainfall is that corresponds to 1 day duration. If it takes 5 minutes, the dangerous rainfall is 5 minutes long. If it takes, an example, 5 minutes is the typical travel time of a sewer system. And the sewer system indeed is flooded by very short-term rainfall, like 5 minutes. We know that. If it takes 2 weeks, like the Po River, for the Po River it takes about, let's say, 1 week, from 1 to 2 weeks, travel time. Then the dangerous rainfall is the rainfall that lasts for 2 weeks. Typically, the longer the rainfall, the lower the intensity. But in terms of volumes, it brings a lot of water. Now, This explains why small rivers are suffer from rainfall that has a duration of one day or maybe half an hour. Like if you see the last floods in Italy, typically they are caused by intense rainfall occurring during summer. So this is a possible explanation, the fact that only short-term rainfall is influenced by global warming is a possible explanation for the fact that we have recently only small floods and not big ones. Indeed, if we look at the Po River, you see the max peak flow from 1920 here to 2009. Look at the Po River, and if you draw a regression line, this regression line here is animated, it's drawn over a time window of 50 years, and it's moving. You see that sometimes it's blue, blue means increasing, red means decreasing, sometimes it's blue, sometimes it's red, and there is not a clear tendency of peak flow to increase. It's fluctuating. We had big floods in the past, also some big floods recently, up to 2000, the last big one was in 2000. But the overall tendency, you cannot really see a big change. Now let's move at the European scale. There have been recently several studies analyzing floods in Europe. And floods in Europe have been analyzed since a long time ago, but a pan-European analysis, which means an extended analysis over Europe, has never been performed because it was a problem up to a few years ago to put the data together. The data were proprietary data, and the various countries basically were a bit reluctant in sharing the data for this reason, because they wanted to be paid, which was a reasonable request. On the other hand, this was a strong limitation. And when we were able, about 10 years ago, to put all the data together, we were finally able to make an analysis, an extensive analysis over Europe. And what has been found, by taking into account that the database which is referred to in this picture refers to big floods, not to small-scale ones. Now the database is being improved, and several additional analyses have been performed on lower floods. But if you look at this picture, it says that there is a pattern over Europe, but the pattern is not homogeneous. So there is an increase over UK, there is a decrease in Spain and Italy. There is no here not yet reported the result for Italy, but for, as I said, for big rivers in Italy there is also a decrease. And the period here is about, I think it's 50 years long, the usual period 1960-2010. And there is an increase over the Alps and over Germany. There is a decrease in the northeast part. So how it is explained, this change, this pattern? It's explained with the fact that indeed there has been a shift of the big perturbations towards the north, which caused a shift of long-term rainfall from the south to the north. So you explain in this way the decrease of floods in the south and the increase over UK. There has been a change with an increase in the floods dominated by snowmelt, with a significant snowmelt contribution, which is explained by the fact that if you anticipate snowmelt, global warming anticipated snowmelt, if you anticipate snowmelt, you have the coincidence, the concurrence between snowmelt and spring rainfall for the rivers like Po which causes a change in seasonality and then the superimposition of flows and therefore possibly floods. So the rivers, especially the small ones that are connected to the Alps, suffer from this situation, suffer from this amplification, and there is an increase of floods. I don't remember the explanation of the decrease in the northeast, which is, if I will remember, again due to a shift in the path of the atmospheric rivers, of the big perturbations. And so the conclusion, the moral of the story is that it's a pattern that is not homogeneous. In some cases, it was found a significant increase, especially where snowmelt dominates. Another thing, same map, is that the same group of researchers found a change in seasonality, which I already mentioned. And the change in seasonality is particularly concerning because it means an anticipated snowmelt, which means that you have less flow during summer, which means droughts. This is particularly relevant for the Po River. For the Po River, we found that during summer, there is indeed a decline of flow, which is due, among the other things, to anticipated snowmelt, because we also found that in April, there is no decrease of flow over the Po River. There is an increase, there is a corresponding increase, which means that change in seasonality. And the change in seasonality, at the beginning we thought that it was not so relevant, but then we realized that both in terms of droughts and in terms of floods is instead relevant. But the picture is a bit complicated, so it is too simplified, the statements floods and droughts are increasing in frequency. It's more complicated and mostly dependent on the local conditions and also on the presence of contribution, significant contribution due to snowmelt and ice melting. In terms of droughts, here it's a figure of La Niña. So La Niña, you see cool in the east of the Pacific Ocean and warm in the west of the Pacific Ocean. And in terms of droughts, a first important thing to be made, to be said, it's impossible to predict them. And also climate models, while they have reasonable performances in the reproduction of extreme precipitation and therefore in flood prediction, in predicting flood changes, they fail in predicting the long droughts. What we found is that indeed for the region here in Bologna, if you look at the climate model predictions, you underestimate the drought risk. This is the conclusion that I want to anticipate. And another important conclusion, which I already mentioned, it's not clear whether there is connection between the large-scale atmospheric patterns and global warming. So it's not clear if the drought risk will is related to the global warming. What is clear is that the impact is increased for the increased, at least potential evaporation. There is a warmer climate and therefore we need more water and therefore the impact of droughts is higher. And also there is more vulnerability of the socioeconomic context, as I said. So it is clear that the risk, which is a combination of hazard, probability of droughts, and damage if a drought occurs, the risk is increased. It's not clear if the probability is going to increase. And for sure, the models are predicting less probability of droughts, but I'm not sure they are correct because in the reproduction of these statistics, they are not very good. I think this is an explanation of El Niño. I already explained it. So if we look again at the Po River and we look at the low flows, this is annual minima of the Po River from 1920 to 2009. Indeed, again, there is a regression line that is 15 years long. you see that it doesn't look like there is up to 2000 a clear pattern. After 2000, we don't see the whole picture here because here the figure is up to 2009. But if we extended it up to now, we would see that in summer there is in summer and therefore, which means minimum flow, there is indeed a consistent declining pattern, which is due to, as I said, anticipation of snowmelt. But actually, it's not easy to find to elaborate a final conclusion. So, what we suggest for the local conditions, as I said, is to look at the historical sequence, take an event from the historical sequence and nominate this event. My preference is for the event for the drought between 1940 and 1950. So nominate this event as a design event for the future. I think this is something that it's more precautionary. Okay, so in saying this, in saying this conclusion, in saying that, in suggesting a procedure for making a future prediction, I got into the issue of climatic prediction. But before I got into the issue of climatic prediction, so describing how we can get projections, how we can make prediction for the future, before getting into it, let me spend a few words, and these few words are not dealt with here and also in the web page, it's not discussed, on this, see the wave dynamics, how it is expected to increase into the, to change into the future, the dynamic of waves. The dynamic of waves is strictly related to the dynamic of wind, of course. And unfortunately, wind is one of the weather variables that are predicted by climate models, but when we talk about extreme winds, the reliability is still limited. So it is problematic to make predictions of the evolution in the future of the wind condition, therefore wave dynamics. So the deductive approach is subjected to a relevant uncertainty. Indeed, the expectation is that extreme events should become more extreme. So, for instance, even hurricanes, there is the expectation and the prediction of models that they become more extremes. But actually, our observations don't confirm that. So, if we go to the sphere of the inductive predictions, first, let's say that we don't have a long record of winds. Also, we don't have long records of sea waves. So, we cannot make the same analysis that we did for rainfall. We don't have for temperature. We have observations starting from 1950, 1960, and these observations have been very sparse, the gauging network was not very, very dense. So it's problematic to derive conclusions. But if we look at the recent past, at the frequency of hurricanes and the frequency of coastal flooding, there is no evidence of an increased frequency of these events. And on the website of Judith Curry, there is, and in the report that I mentioned to you earlier, there is a discussion on this. And indeed, there is also a special report for hurricanes, where it's clear that there is little evidence for confirming that there is an increase And also, it's impossible to quantify this increase. So at present, the suggestion that I give for coastal flooding is the same as for drought. So let's keep the traditional approach, because it's the most precautionary one. If we want to, in a way, to get more protected, the technical suggestion is increase the safety factor, increase the allowance for freeboard of something that can be plus 20%. So if we were used to a safety factor of 1.5, let's bring it to 1.7, 1.8, which is probably safe. It's probably, from the technical point of view, the more appropriate approach. By the way, this suggestion of plus 20% for the design variable in the presence of climate change comes up very frequently by technicians, by waterboard managers, by people operating over the field. And I noticed independent sources bringing this suggestion forward. And of course, you have to make a cost-benefit analysis. So in some of the cases, you will see that getting protected against a risk, like a coastal flooding, with an increased allowance of 20% wouldn't imply a big change of costs. In other cases, you may find big changes. And therefore, the cost-benefit analysis is useful to identify to what extent you can safely and in a way smoothly increasing your safety factor, smoothly in terms of cost effectiveness. So I understand that I'm not providing a very useful suggestion. On the other hand, the problem is relevant, and as engineers, we need solutions. So I think this is probably the best solution that one can give. This is the subject of discussions, debates, but I think that an empirical approach for what concerns coastal flooding up to now is the best solution. Now, climate change predictions. So I am extending a little bit this reasoning, which I just concluded. There are climate variables that are easier to predict with respect to others. Temperature is easier. Rainfall is more complicated. Wind velocity, probably, it's even more complicated. And also, you know, temperature changes at the global level is easier. Changes at the local level becomes not so easy. And what is the reason? The reason is that there are several reasons, but think of the behavior of temperature and the behavior of rainfall. Rainfall is highly varying in space and time. Highly varying. Temperature is not so highly varying. So this is a very simple reason why predicting temperature is easier than predicting rainfall. Also wind. The wind is highly varying in space and time. Winds, if you consider the gust of the wind, how to predict a gust, the intensity of a gust? It's so varying in time. It's so sudden. You need a very detailed description in space and time. This is one very simple reason, which is related to spatial and temporal variability. And if you know something of probability, it's related to the probability distribution of rainfall data and temperature data. Temperature data are close to Gaussian, and rainfall data are anything but Gaussian. So this is why making making a prediction for a Gaussian variable, it's much easier. Gaussian means linearity, and therefore it's much easier than rainfall and wind. Also, wind speed is anything but Gaussian. And so let's have a look at the predictions of global warming for the future. And you can see that different models have a large spread. What we often do is, you see that the spread is goes to zero at the current time. Also in the past reconstructions, in the reconstruction of the past, different models have different responses. What we usually do, first of all, these are called projections, not predictions, because it's not clear why, but I think the reason is that prediction means something more quantitative with respect to projections. They are aware of uncertainty, and therefore they prefer not to call them predictions. A possible solution here is to take the average, but if you take the average between the different models, you account for uncertainty due to different modeling interpretation. But let's assume that they are all wrong. They are all overestimating. If you take the average, you don't solve the problem. So there is a part of uncertainty that is not quantified by taking the average. Second, in practice, if you take the average between different models for rainfall, you eliminate variability in time, because by taking an average, you minimize variability in time. So it's not, we often are told that we use ensemble prediction. Ensemble mean several different models, and then you take the average or you take an envelope. But this is not solving the problem of uncertainty. If you look at the projection of rainfall, uncertainty is much higher. So you need to refer to long time periods. You cannot make a prediction for a given year. You cannot make a prediction for a given day, even if the models, they give you a prediction for a day. But you don't have to look at the prediction for one day. You have to look at the average over the long period, like rainfall, average rainfall over 10 years. Because in this way, uncertainty is a little bit minimized. So, I mean, climate models are good for getting an indication of change, but not for getting a prediction. And it depends on the variables. Okay, now let's move towards the solution here. And in these last 20 minutes, I want to talk about solutions. So what could be the solution to climate change? There are two main avenues. One avenue is climate change mitigation, and the second avenue is climate change adaptation. Let's go back to mitigation. Mitigation means that we mitigate climate change. Adaptation means that we mitigate the impact of climate change. Mitigation means that we can try to remove climate change. Adaptation means that we accept climate change and adapt to it by protecting ourselves. So mitigation means that we act over the drivers of climate change, and we try to contrast, to eliminate these drivers. So given that we are convinced that climate change is human induced, and is induced in particular by our CO2 emissions, mitigation, the key to mitigation is a decrease of CO2 concentration in the atmosphere. This may be reached with different actions. A first action is decrease of emissions, which means what we know. There are several plans which have been agreed to minimize our emission by acting on transportation, acting on industrial production, acting on energy transition, transition to renewable sources. The problem is much complicated because, for instance, hydroelectric power is a renewable source. It doesn't produce directly CO2. Energy production doesn't produce CO2, but you need facilities, you need infrastructures. Building these infrastructures means CO2 emissions. So, I mean, we need a careful evaluation of the impact of each action on the carbon cycle. But for sure, this is an avenue. So we reduce the CO2 emissions by humans. Another avenue may be that we capture the CO2 from the atmosphere and store it somewhere, which is different from the atmosphere. These are also called geoengineering methods. For instance, it is widely practiced the technique of capturing carbon from the atmosphere and injecting it into the soil. Into, for instance, geological formations where there was fuel, oil and gas. So the same plants that we used for extracting oil and gas can be used to reinject the CO2 into the soil. The idea is try to accelerate the natural process of carbon capture by the vegetation. How have been oil and gas deposits formed? Through carbon capture through the vegetation from the atmosphere, vegetation decomposition, and inclusion of the remains into the soil, which means this process that we well know that brought to oil and gas. So the idea is let's try to accelerate it, let's capture with artificial methods the carbon from the atmosphere and let's store it into the soil where it will become eventually oil and gas in the far future. However, there are a bit of concern. First of all, it is expensive. And second, there are concerns because it's not clear whether storing the CO2it's a gas, into the soil, there are concerns that the CO2 may leak to the surface through cracks, through other pores, and therefore it's not clear if it remains there. But this is a possibility. Other possibility are storage of CO2 into the underground, for instance, in galleries that have been dismissed or tunnels that have been dismissed with several different techniques. Another possibility is to use ecosystem services because the vegetation is a carbon sink, and therefore by increasing afforestation, we increase the capability of vegetation worldwide to capture CO2. There are a lot of researches ongoing on these techniques. These researches aim to quantify what is the effectiveness, how to better organize the distribution of these ecosystems. Of course, these are also techniques that have to be applied at the large scale. It's not just enough that a country acts in this. It's necessary a global coordination, which it's not easy. And all of these techniques There is to say an important thing, they would be effective, if they were effective, they would be effective in the long time scale. So we don't get an immediate reaction of the climate system to this reduction of CO2, even if, I mean, after COVID, it looks like it's not clear if there has been an effect on global warming of the lockdown, but we cannot exclude it. So, I mean, the time scale is not clear. There is the feeling that at least in part of it, for part of it, it will be a long scale process because of the inertia of the climate system. But this is something that is not very clear. For sure, it is an action that requires a global coordination. For sure, it is an action whose time scale is not clear. For sure, it is something very expensive. Now, also in terms of these behaviors, expensiveness and global behavior and time scale, there is a huge difference, and now we pass to adaptation. With adaptation, adaptation is can be effective at the local scale, because think of adaptation, think of coastal flooding. If I build a seawall, the effect is immediate, so the time scale is rapid, the effectiveness is local, which means a direct benefit for the local people, and the scale, I mean, the responsibility is by the local administration. So we don't require a global coordination. This is very relevant. Think of it, because responsibility of the local administration may imply that the local administration tends to avoid it rather than preferring it. Because, of course, taking a responsibility, recognizing a responsibility means a risk. On the other hand, it's clear that the optimal solution would be an integration of these two avenues. Because if the time scale is different, if adaptation is never forever, because clearly there is, I cannot adapt to everything that may happen into the future. Given that the spatial scale is also complementary, the optimal solution would be an integration. But the problem is that we don't have enough resources to pay for everything, and also we still don't have the capability to coordinate a global level to reach an efficient integration, which is something that we have to realize, and to realize with the purpose of reaching, at least at the global level, a solution that avoids the major impacts now. So, where there is an immediate threat, not a predicted one, an immediate threat to people and goods, we need to act now. And the way to act now is adaptation. So let's keep, note the difference and be aware of the difference of a predicted threat and a current threat. This is why engineers, and I am a supporter of this interpretation, tend to make a difference between predictions and analysis of the current problems. And we always start from the analysis of the current problem. So let's solve first the problems now. And then let's take into account that new problem may come into play in the future, So in designing our solutions, whenever it's possible, let's maximize resilience of the solution to future changes. So in Italy now we have a problem of flooding, coastal flooding and river flooding. We need solutions now, and in designing these solutions, let's give preference to flexible approaches. So to give you an example, the MOSE is a good solution for the problems of Venice now, and I think the MOSE has been a good idea, because now it's protecting Venice. But we also know that the MOSE is, if the sea level will increase again in the future of other 20 centimeters, maybe not enough. So now we are in the position of starting to think about Venice in the future. So what can we do in the future? Because we solved the current problem, but I think it was first necessary to solve the current problem. I don't know if it would be possible to make a design of the MOSE that is that lends itself to flexibility. I would say not. But in any case, I think that the approach was correct. So let's start from solving the current problem, and now we are in the position of starting thinking at the future. Here you can see some examples of solution for climate change adaptation. First, this slide presents some principles that we have to take into account in the design. And some of these principles we already discussed. Let's have a look. The effect of climate change vary by region. We already discussed this. The effects of climate change may vary across demographic groups. We didn't discuss this much. And this is indeed important. And when you have impacts of natural hazards or human-induced hazards, these impacts are always heavier for the people who have less resources. And these impacts increase the diversity and the disparity. Diversity is not a good term because it's a positive one. The disparity. These impacts increase the disparity of in disparity between people. Climate change poses both risk and opportunities. We discussed this, and when I said if we look at the past, during warming periods we had more prosperity. So let's try to identify these opportunities, because it may be a way to optimize our adaptation. The effect of climate change must be considered in the context of multiple stressor factors, which may be important. So multiple reasons for climate change. So let's also consider that there is natural variability, for instance. Adaptation comes at a cost. We already discussed it. Adaptive responses vary in effectiveness, as demonstrated by current effort to cope with climate variability, which means that an integration of approaches may be the best solutions. The systemic nature of climate impacts complicates the development of adaptation policy. Yes, of course, climate impacts are related with, connected by feedbacks, interaction. We already discussed this. Maladaptation can result in negative effects. So let's keep into account that there is a responsibility in that. And now let's see a possible list of solutions, and here there is not focus on the coastal areas. I will try to integrate this list with the focus on the coastal areas. So installing protective and or resilient technologies and materials in properties that are prone to flooding, this can be adapted to coastal areas. It means waterproof buildings, for instance, or it means protections against saltwater intrusion. When you have coastal flooding, a relevant problem is saltwater intrusion, which is exacerbated, and you may get freshwater lands in the underground contaminated. So one possibility is to put in place protective screens like jet groutings in order to to build a barrier against saltwater intrusion in the underground. So this is certainly a possibility. Changing to heat tolerant tree varieties, yes, because we need to make sure that vegetation ecosystems are impacted to the minimum extent, and therefore we have to avoid the situation like the windstorm, the Vaia, that occurred in the Dolomites in 2018. It caused big damage, which is still being recovered in terms of fallen trees. The impact was caused, the event was indeed an extreme event, but the big problem there was that after the deforestation during the Second World War, they planted only red pines with they used a dominance of red pines to make afforestation, and the reason is that the red pine is faster in growing up, but the red pine is weak in terms of roots. The roots are very superficial, and also the structure of the tree is very weak. So this was the problem. They had a big loss in diversity, a big loss of trees, because the forests that they planted were less resilient against strong winds. So this is the problem that we have to avoid. So we have to preserve ecosystems under climate change. Rainwater storage has a double benefit. First, it reduces the flow in the sewer system, so it minimizes the risk of urban flooding. And second, it allows to save water for irrigation later on, which means less groundwater withdrawal, which means less saltwater intrusion. So rainwater storage is, for instance, has been widely promoted in Australia during the long drought from 2001 to 2010. It turned out to be effective. The problem that was experienced, because they used home storages at the scale of single homes, the problem that they experienced is that these tanks, because they use tanks in order to harvest rainwater, these tanks need continuous maintenance. Without maintenance, the quality of the water that is stored becomes very bad. But rainwater storage is a good idea. Reducing paved areas to deal with rainwater and to increase infiltration. Increasing infiltration over the land is a very efficient solution against saltwater intrusion. So here I'm recalling again the benefit that you may achieve in coastal areas. Coastal areas suffer of saltwater intrusion for groundwater exploitation and also for reduced recharge. Adding green roofs and green walls, this minimizes the impact of rainwater on sewer systems and also allows to reach a better isolation of buildings with respect to hot waves. It's a better protection that allows also to save in a cooling system, in energy consumption for cooling, which is indeed very important. Requiring waterfront properties to have a higher foundation against erosion, and this may be also waterfront properties, we may also mean the properties that are in front of the coasts, so better foundations to better cope with coastal erosions. Raising pumps at wastewater treatment plants means enhancing the use of treated wastewater. For irrigation, this is a very good possibility. Also, in some countries, in Europe, it's not allowed. In some countries, they use already wastewater for supplying drinking water to people. Of course, the treatment must be complying with the local regulations. In Europe, it's not yet allowed. but I think we will get there. And surveying local vulnerabilities, monitoring is extremely important, also for coastal flooding. Whenever we suspect that we have not enough information, we need to increase monitoring. Incentivizing lighter colored roofs, installing device to prevent seawater from backflowing into storm drains, because the backflowing of salt water in the sewer system is also a problem. Installing better flood defenses such as seawalls and increased pumping capacity. Buying out homeowners in flood-prone areas, including coastal areas. Raising street level to prevent flooding, also coastal flooding. I think this is the last one, yes. So I hope that I provided an overview that is comprehensive enough. I am aware of the fact that this is a complex problem that cannot be quantitatively dealt with in only one lecture. But as I said, I'm not interested in the quantitative teaching within this course. I am interested in the orders of magnitude, but I think it is important that you get an overview, because climate change in coastal areas is an issue, is indeed an issue. Okay, I think we got there. Any question? Let me share the screen. And let me stop the presentation.
No question. No question. Thank you, Prof.